Welcome to the spring Business Analytics Lecture Series. My name is Matt Lavatore, Director of the Center for Business Analytics in Villanova. I welcome you all today. We have a fantastic speaker about to present behind you, Alicia Rankin from the NFL. Let me just read a little bit about Alicia's background. Ms. Alicia Rankin joined the National Football League in October 2007 to oversee the research department and work closely with the NFL marketing and sales teams. Alicia's role is to understand and increase the NFL fan base of 200 million people and to strategically expand the NFL brand into other growth opportunity businesses. Prior to the NFL, Alicia spent 7 years at ESPN overseeing all qualitative and quantitative research projects regarding ESPN, all its networks, and its brand extensions, such as ESPN.com and ESPN the magazine. During her tenure there, she single-handedly built the Consumer Insights Department to provide strategic research across the entire company. Prior to ESPN, Alicia worked at ROI Research and Sponsorship Research International, SRI lowercase, two research companies specializing in sports sponsorship research. At both firms, she was responsible for conducting and managing the sponsorship research programs of such clients as NFL properties and championship auto racing teams. In the course of the last 20 years, she has managed major research studies and consulting engagements covering 20 different countries worldwide. Ms. Rankin graduated from Lehigh University in 1991 with a BS in marketing with a concentration in market research and statistics. She and her husband and three daughters reside in New Jersey. Please join me in giving a warm Villanova welcome to Ms.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me? Good. I'm not used to being double mic, so I'm not quite sure what this is going to do to me or not do to me. Thank you very much, Matt. I really appreciate being here. Yes, I graduated from Lehigh University, not too far from here, but I will tell you, Villanova was a very close second in my decision making. So I definitely have an affinity towards Villanova. I'm a big fan of the basketball team and everything else that you do. Know lots of people that obviously went here. Is actually my friend Brian Cull, who got me to come here and present. So very much enjoy Villanova and definitely look forward to making visits here with my own kids someday. So anyway, thank you very much. I'm proud to be here representing the NFL. It's always fun for me, you know, here it is, middle of April, no games going on, and talking NFL, right? Does that sound pretty cool to everybody? NFL fans in the room, we got a few? Just a few, that's it? That's it? Excellent. How many of you have been to games recently? Yeah? Excellent. How many of you play fantasy football? Great. So name the teams that you're fans of. Bears, Steelers, Eagles. Who else? Patriots, Falcons? Cowboys. Giants. Jets. I'm loving it, right? See? I think we got all 32 represented in here. Yeah? Seahawks fans, Falcons fans, Buccaneers fans, Chargers fans. It's great. So what I want to do briefly is just take you through a little bit of my own role in the research department at the NFL. So we're a very small group, but we really serve so many different groups throughout the entire league and to the teams to varying extents as well. So everything that we do, these are all the different departments that we cover and service. So it ranges from everything from Nielsen ratings in terms of measuring, you know, how many people are tuning into our various games week in and week out. It's looking at all of our sponsorship deals that we have with our various partners and understanding how we can provide ROI back to them in terms of all their dollar investment and making sure they're getting their money's worth. It's looking at from a branding standpoint. The NFL is a very strong brand, and that's a lot of what I'll spend my time talking about, but it's understanding, you know, what makes us a strong brand, making sure we stay a strong brand, and really managing our brand going forward, and also our league, our teams as well. It's, consumer products is a very big business for us. Who owns who owns a jersey or some type of merchandise, right? Most, a lot of people in this room, it's big business, and we try to keep on continuing to expand that role. We came out with a new women's apparel line, working on behalf of those folks to make sure anything new that we're putting out there is what you as fans are all wanting. You know, from a corporate development standpoint, it's kind of growing our revenue. So it's looking strategically at new businesses that the NFL can get into. And in some cases, it may not even be NFL or football related. It's just kind of figuring out those investments that just, you know, like any good investor, would be smart investments to make going forward. And so we'll help evaluate those types of issues. You know, entertainment marketing. You know, how many times have you watched a program on TV and you actually saw a character perhaps in a jersey? That doesn't happen without the NFL's permission. And we don't let it happen for a program that perhaps is not representing our brand well. So there's lots of programs out there that may be about football and, you know, fans of football, but you're never really seeing like a logo on them. And there's a reason for that, because they have to get our permission, and we don't always allow it. We make sure that anything that's out there, whether it's a movie, whether it's TV, anything, represents the brand the way that we would like it to be represented. So our entertainment marketing group goes through scripts beyond scripts of anything NFL related and make sure they're what we call on brand as opposed to off brand. So it's entertainment marketing. International, and hopefully we'll definitely talk about that later, but I mean, we're growing. We're not just you know, not just domestic. We play games over in London every year, so we spend a lot of time trying to figure out strategically. First we spend a lot of time just understanding whether that was working or not working, but then we spend a lot of time strategically. So for example, this year we are actually playing two games over in London this year, as opposed to one that we've been playing the past 5 years. So we spend a lot of time on the research side figuring out, you know, how that works. And then, you know, digital side, NFL.com, NFL Mobile, all our various subscription products, we support them as well. And then, you know, in the bottom right, teams. Rarely does a team have anybody from a research side on staff. It's generally someone in marketing who kind of plays a research role. So our group will, again, aid all the teams in providing different types of research to them as well. So it runs the gamut, which makes my day-to-day very exciting. It's definitely something different every day. You never know what you're going to get. And no matter how many to-do lists I write every day, by the end of the day, it's, you know, it never comes out the way you expected, because there's always something that comes up. So, and just to briefly talk about, you know, some of the tools that we use. I know some of you are in the market research field or looking to get into it. And a lot of the tools we use is kind of what we first call syndicated research. So it's where we're kind of buying off-the-shelf research out there. Nielsen, the ratings I mentioned earlier, are probably the most popular and the most expensive that we buy. But we'll look at different things in terms of just kind of product usage. Web analytics as well. We also do what we call valuation from our media standpoint, and that very simply is a very simplistic measure, but in our games, you'll probably see Gatorade in the background or Nike on the jerseys. We value that so that, you know, Gatorade spends a lot of money to be our sponsor, and they want to make sure that they're being seen by as wide of audience as possible. And we value literally how many seconds and how much time is on screen and what that translates into a value for them. So we do a lot of that media evaluation. But separately, we have our own kind of what we call proprietary tools that, you know, comes out of, we manufacture and we create ourselves. And one of the tools that we have is best used is what we call our simply weekly NFL fan tracker. And what we do is we interview 300 fans every week online, different group of fans every week. And we run them through, you know, a bunch of different questions. It's a very standard questionnaire with a lot of changes throughout. So there's a kind of a core group of questions. But then, you know, we all have NFL draft coming up. So next week we'll probably put some NFL draft questions on and then keep them on for a few weeks and take them off. And then whatever the next, you know, activity is, we'll put some other questions on relevant to that. But really, that's representative of our fan base and gives us a really good read across all of our fans across a bunch of different measures. We separately have in our own internet panel of fans. It's about 10,000 fans who, it's not representative of anybody except a bunch of vocal fans who have no problem giving us their opinion. So I don't know how many of you belong to different other, you know, panels out there of perhaps you know, maybe a retailer or just other things that you like and engage with. But it's a panel we'll send out, survey every once in a while, trying to gauge your opinion among this group. It's a great way to kind of get a lot of kind of texture and qualitative information behind a lot of the numbers that we put in as well. So that's a great panel that we use. And then, you know, the last thing is really, it's kind of an open-ended thing. We do lots of different types of custom research. We spend a lot of time, we go out to a lot of the games on behalf of the teams. We'll interview fans there on site. We'll either have, you know, an iPad, iPod, some type of handheld that we can kind of very quickly get access to. Focus groups, I imagine most of you are familiar with. We do focus groups around the country on all sorts of different topics. You know, bring in a group of fans, you know, have fun, you know, sitting behind the glass eating M&Ms. And then ethnography in terms of really, you know, getting into someone's world a little closer and not necessarily following them around with a camera per se, but having them kind of do assignments every week where perhaps they're, you know, uploading their own videos to us of what they're doing and how they're engaging with the NFL. So we do a myriad of research that really runs the gamut in terms of methodologies. We try to keep up to date with a lot of the latest methodologies, whether it's on the mobile side or, you know, kind of the qual quant type of stuff that's out there. There's a lot of different things that are in the research world, and we try to stay on top of it and figure out the best way to use it. So I want to take you through, and this is kind of really just meant to be a thought starter. We'll definitely have some Q&A throughout, and feel free to shoot some questions at me. But this is a deck that I wanted to share that really goes through, as kind of the name suggests, power of the NFL. These are our best points about the NFL, and this is something my group produces every year. And it's meant not only for everybody internally to be on the same page of all those great things, but we use it with all of our external partners, whether it's a current partner that we have or going after new partners or new licensees. Anybody who just wants to generally understand the NFL, this is the deck that we start with. So the first thing we love to start with is how popular the NFL is. So the NFL is the number one sport in America. So we actually record-breaking this year in terms of having 185 million fans, but we've been number one on this measure for as long as this poll has existed. And you can see the gap between us, we're twice as much as MLB, and we've always been in that number one position. And it's not just that we're number one, we're number one and among every different demo. So men, women, African Americans, teens, Hispanics, we are number one among a lot of different groups. So again, I mentioned the 185 million fans, which is great. It continues to grow each year. And very simplistically, you know, there's a lot of companies that have very fancy segmentations out there and all their, you know, consumers and cutesy names for their consumers. In the sports world, and I've been in the sports world a long time, it really comes down to very simplistically avid versus casual. And how it is defined, very basically, is an interest level scale. So if you're someone who's very interested in the NFL, you're an avid fan. So how many are avid fans? Good chunk of you, that's great. So people are always about, well, shouldn't it be about how much, you know, merchandise you buy or how many games you watch? Fair point, but think about it. April 12th, if I defined you by how many games you're watching this past week, there wouldn't be anybody who's an avid fan in this room, right? So we make sure that we use metrics that work across a couple things, work across the entire year, and work across every sports industry as well, so that we can measure ourselves against other sports. So if you ask someone how many, even if it's, you know, middle of October, and you're asking somebody how many games are you watching, you compare us to MLB, where there's a heck of a lot more games on, or any of the other sports, it's not a fair measure. So what we do is we profile you, or we define you by interest, and then we profile you by behavior. So avid fans, you know, are more likely to buy merchandise, more likely to watch us on TV. But again, very simply, avid versus casual. And the one thing that we're proud of is not only are we a very big fan base, but about half of our fans are avid fans. And to put that in context, across all the other sports that are measured, about 20-25% will be avid. So if you think about, and I'm not picking on tennis by any means, but if you think about a lot of tennis fans, they're generally interested perhaps in the four majors. Right, and then they're not necessarily paying attention to everything else that's going on. Maybe a little Davis Cup here and there, but generally, it's kind of for the majority of people who are tennis fans in the country. It's, you know, it's the Wimbledon, it's the U.S. Open, and then they're not really, you know, paying attention to anything else. Our fans are paying attention all year round, which is great. Importantly for us is understanding how someone became a fan, when they became a fan. So, anybody, tell me your story of how you became a fan. Anybody? How'd you become a fan? As a little boy with relatives, right? Anybody else? How did you become a fan? Yes.
I went to my first Patriots game when I was 3. My dad's had season tickets for 30 years.
And you've been hooked since? Excellent. Anybody else become a fan different way? Went to a game? Yes.
When the Eagles hired Dick Vermeil in 1976.
And you just kind of liked it, and you're an Eagles fan since then. And anybody else?
Yeah. First time I put on pads and hit somebody.
So you played. Excellent. So lots of different ways, but I think the tendency is it was at when you were younger, right? So whether you played, whether you're watching, whether you actually went to a game, perhaps you had the chance to meet a player when you were younger. We see that the majority of our fans, our avid fans, more than half of them, became fans at a very young age. So it's no different than any other brand out there. You know, get them while they're young, and hopefully they'll be loyal throughout. We're the same way. We know that if we engage you at a very young age, chances of you staying a fan, and especially an avid fan, and engaging with us throughout is very high. So we spend a lot of time, you know, from a strategic effort, you know, spending a lot of time on the youth side and making sure whether it's flag football, punt, pass, and kick. So from a football participation, we make sure that's still strong. We make sure that we've developed video games and other types of things that are, you know, fantasy football games for younger kids as well. Because we know that we want to get you in. We've also developed with Nicktoons, there's a cartoon now, Rush Zone Guardians, it's on Nicktoons, and it was a half-hour show throughout the season. So perhaps you're not watching a football game. You know, maybe you're just someone who kind of likes that, you know, cartoon, adventure, comedy type of show, and we get you hooked that way. Whatever way we can try to get you in the door, that's the way we'll do it, and hopefully you'll stay a fan through life. This is a very busy chart, but kind of going back to my point earlier in terms of we define you as an avid and casual. This is one of the ways that we profile you. So in our weekly tracker that I referenced earlier, we look at how much time you spent across every different touch point on the NFL. And sometimes the touch point's TV, it can be mobile, it can be internet, it could be podcast, it could be fantasy, video games, it could be just doing what we're doing now, just talking about football. So we look at that and we kind of create this wheel to know that on average, an average fan spends 9 hours, this is during season, not necessarily this week, spends over 9 hours, almost 9.5 hours per week engaged with the NFL. And then for an avid fan, it's about 14 hours. Does that sound about right to you, or does that seem high or low? Is that crazy? Or are you sitting there going, I actually do more than that? So this is a great way that we measure, and the beauty of, because our tracker runs every week, we can see how this changes throughout the season. Now, don't get me wrong, like TV, so right now, so again, this was in season. Obviously, TV right now is going to be lower, but just because there's no, you know, 3-hour games and 7-hour windows going to be on a Sunday. So we can see that they're engaging a lot more through our digital platforms right now. But then, you know, draft in a few weeks, you know, TV will go up. A lot of things will change, and it's very interesting to see the dynamics change. Obviously, fantasy football is going to be, you know, pretty non-existent. Right now, people spend a little bit more time on video games during our off season. So we look at this and we help see where, you know, time spent is changing. And what we actually see is time continues to grow, but the percentages of the different dynamics, you know, digital, new media usage continues to take a slightly bigger chunk of the percentage as well. So this is a great way that we just kind of look at how our fans are engaging with us. The very last point is something we spent a lot of time this past year on, which is all about simultaneous usage. And, you know, many of you, I'm sure when you're watching TV, you're probably multitasking, you got the smartphone. There's probably a bunch of you using your smartphone right now while I'm speaking, who knows. So you're spending a lot of time doing a lot of different things, and sometimes it may be about the game you're watching. More often than not, it's probably about something else that you're doing. If you're a fantasy football player, you're probably checking, you know, your scores and your stats and everything else right along with it. And so we're trying to really measure that because it's a very tricky thing to get a good handle on from a media usage standpoint is how much time people are spending. And then understanding the devices. Is it TV and computer? Is it TV and, you know, smartphone? Is it TV and tablet, which we're seeing a tremendous increase in use of as well. So This helps us really understand our fans and again, profiling them from a behavior standpoint. So focusing a little bit on TV because, you know, TV is still where the bulk of our money gets made in terms of, you know, ratings that we do and the amount of money that broadcast the CBSs and the NBCs, you know, pay us is, so this is Nielsen ratings. And what this looks at is over the past 10 years, how the NFL stacks up to the competitor sports in terms of just overall average rating for our games. And we also throw in a line for broadcast, which just represents all broadcast TV. And then what you'll see is, so a couple things here as well. Broadcast TV, which is the second line, the I guess the blue purplish line, broadcast TV has actually gone down. And that's a function of just the proliferation of cable. So there's so many more channels people can watch right now. So you're less likely to just watch your standard broadcast, your ABCs, your CBSs, NBCs, Fox. There's so many other things you're probably all watching. So the average rating for just generic broadcast TV continues to decrease. And then if you look at the competitor sports, outside of the NBA, which has had a nice bump the past couple years, it's amazing what their lockout has actually done for them. But in the majority of it, it's kind of stayed flat, right? I mean, it certainly hasn't grown any tremendous rate. So not only, again, is the NFL strong and you know, above the other numbers, but we've actually, for the most part, continued to have grown over the past couple of years. So again, it just shows you the popularity of our brand. And we spend a lot of time making sure that we're a strong brand and you know, keep these numbers as high as we can. And we can't talk about the NFL on TV without talking about the best brand that we have out there, and that's our Super Bowl. How many of you watched the Super Bowl this past year? I would arguably say that's by far and away the most of you. And the Super Bowl is like no other property out there. I mean, for even people who aren't fans, how many people are, you know, gathered around, you know, watching the game, or even arguably watching the commercial? I mean, who else talks about, I want to at least see the commercials in that program? I mean, there's no other program out there that you're sitting there saying, I have to watch the commercials for that. So the Super Bowl, if you stack it up against really anything, whether it's other, you know, finals from other sports or even the Olympics or even, you know, just award ceremonies out there, you know, that appeal to perhaps a different group, Super Bowl is really like no other. And every year it continues to do very well. We broke another record in terms of having the most viewed people ever watch it. This is a program in U.S. history. Almost 165 million people watched the Super Bowl this past year. And we've been very fortunate that we've obviously had some really great games recently, and that keeps driving the interest. But Super Bowl is definitely like no other sport and program out there. So this is the interactive portion. So who can name, so these are the top favorite sports teams. And this is across all sports, but I will tell you the majority of this list, that the top 10 list I'll show you, is NFL teams. So prize for the winner here. Who can name, I'm debating whether to make this tricky, but who can name the top three NFL teams on this list? And I'll see if you can get it, but in the order as well. Nick.
Patriots and Cowboys.
All right, you got 2 out of 3. Yes, sir. Cowboys, yes, that's it. Can someone give me the order? So hold it. Cowboys, Packers, Steelers. Give me the order of 1, 2, 3. Yes, sir.
Steelers, Packers, Cowboys.
Try again.
Cowboys, Steelers, Packers.
You got a winner right here, buddy. So there we go. The Cowboys have been the most popular team. Can you actually just pass that back? Thank you. There's a little Super Bowl notebook for you. So all but a couple years when the Lakers had their three-peat a while ago, the Cowboys have always been number one on this list, by far. And which is always a fascinating thing, because if you think about, and I know a couple Cowboys fans here, you know, very strong team, but you know, they haven't won a Super Bowl very recently. And it's amazing when we get into branding of just how strong they really are as a brand. And whether you're watching them to win, lose, it doesn't really matter. They're an incredible brand. And then the Steelers, same thing, you know, Steeler Nation, right? We have a lot of Steeler fans here as well. And the Packers, you can see that actually they've moved up a little bit in the past couple of years. And then, you know, these other sports that we don't talk about very often, but you have the Yankees and then, you know, the Lakers. And then you can see, you know, Broncos have obviously moved up quite a bit. You know, Peyton does wonders for teams. But, I mean, look at the Miami Heat. I mean, just talk about another team. I mean, they were irrelevant for many years, even though they had won. And then, you know, when LeBron comes to town, and they certainly do well, they pop up. New Orleans Saints obviously had a lot of brand equity from winning the Super Bowl. If you look back 10 years ago, Saints would have been nowhere near the top 10 list. And then the 49ers always a very popular team. Now it's been the first time in a while that they've crept up into the top 10 as well. So it's a great thing for us to see as many NFL teams up there as that there are. But you know, it's interesting. When we show this chart to the commissioner, his first answer is, why aren't all 10 teams NFL teams? So which is a great point. You know, why can't they be? And so we actually spend a lot of time, and I'm more than happy to, you know, talk about it afterwards, spend a lot of time on a branding perspective to figure out how teams could be as great a brand as the Cowboys and all be, you know, again, the top 32 spots on this entire list. So speaking of brands, this is something, it's called a brand asset valuer that's used quite a bit in the business world. And the beauty of this metric is it's used across every business out there. It has nothing to do with sports. It's industry agnostic. And what it really tells you, it kind of gives you the life cycle of a brand. So if I actually try this pointer thing. Oops, sorry. So, okay, that's probably not working. Anyway, so on the bottom left, so let's say you're a new brand, you come to town, people don't know anything about you. You start in that lower left corner. Nobody knows anything about you, you're just new, you're starting up. But you know, as people become more familiar with whatever your brand is and they realize it's kind of relevant to them, they might check it out a little bit, you start moving into that, you know, top left corner. And then as more and more people become familiar with you and you become more popular and you're really serving a need for a lot of people, you move into that top right, the leadership category. And the goal for any brand, regardless of the NFL or anybody, is you hope to stay there, right? Unfortunately for a lot of brands, is they don't stay relevant to a lot of consumers like yourselves. And what happens is they decline. And you don't want to cross that little dotted line, is what you don't want to do from a branding standpoint. And then, you know, once you're in the bottom right, you got a lot of issues that you got to deal with. So, why we show this chart is obviously because the NFL is a very strong leadership brand, and we're in a great position. And I mentioned it earlier, the only thing that actually surpasses us from a brand standpoint is the Super Bowl, which is incredible. I mean, you saw the numbers earlier, and you know the number of you that raised your hands as well. I mean, the Super Bowl, again, a tremendous event, and the equity in that event is tremendous. And you know, we plotted just some of the other sports out there. And don't get me wrong, I'm a huge sports fan, not just NFL. And you know, I love NHL. NHL has been around a long time, and they're still hanging in that bottom left, right? I mean, that's not where you want to be for a brand that's been around a long time. They have an incredibly avid fan base in terms of passion. It's just a smaller fan base, so not everybody's engaged, not everyone finds it relevant, not everyone kind of grew up playing hockey. So they have a little bit of a challenge kind of getting out of that box. You know, NBA is an interesting one. NBA has done they're so player-driven. I mean, if you're NBA fans, they're so player-driven. I mean, you had Johnson and Bird, and then you kind of dip down. You had Jordan come in, and then, well, you dip down, and he'd kind of retire or unretire, and it would pop back up. It was very odd there for a while. And then it really wasn't until LeBron kind of really took over the past couple of years. But the NBA had lost a lot of fans in that. After Jordan left, they lost a tremendous number of fans that just weren't interested. They didn't like the style of play. Mostly older, so probably not necessarily a lot of you in that room. But a lot of people just didn't like it. And it wasn't only really until recently that they've done a really good job not only marketing themselves, but really showcasing a lot of their other teams. They're still in that kind of area. You don't suddenly pop back up into the leadership brand. It takes a while. But they've marketed themselves much better. But, you know, NASCAR and MLB, I mean, they're very tough. I mean, MLB, their fan base continues to get older. Average fan is about 55 years old. That's not where you want to be as a sport. To put that in ours is like 43-ish, 44-ish. So MLB's tough. I mean, you know, I think about even my own kids. They don't want to sit there watching, you know, pitching changes after pitching. It's a slow sport to watch. I mean, it's a great day at the ball game and the strategy behind it. But you know, for kids, and I don't know, maybe perhaps some of you in this room, it's just so slow, and it's just not relevant to a lot of, especially younger people today. And NASCAR, you know, when I was at ESPN, NASCAR was it was a very big thing, and we spent a lot of time making sure we got the rights to it. And it's been very interesting to see how that sport has evolved. And in many ways, they peaked. They peaked, and they just they're hanging on. They still do well, but they're never. It's very tough for them to reclaim, you know, their status when you know the original Dale Earnhardt was around. And you know, if you're a NASCAR fan, you know they've actually opened up some of the rules. There's a little bit more, you know, bumping going on. They've done some things to try to bring back the old NASCAR to kind of make it more relevant. They actually, if you're a fan, you know that the car that they use this year is a car that more resembles a car that you could buy in the street type of thing. They wanted to make it more relevant to a younger generation. So again, they're doing things from a marketing standpoint because as a brand, they're hanging on. They're not definitely as strong as they could be. But you know, going back to the NFL, I mean, it's great that we're in that position, but just as much as I made the comment about the commissioner 2 seconds ago is that we don't really rest on our laurels of being a number one. We don't sit there and look at these numbers and say, oh, our work is done. We can go home now and be all is good. We spend a lot of time making sure that we stay in that position and get stronger. If it was possible to move up, we would move up. So we spend a lot of time on branding efforts and everything that we do at the league to make sure we stay in a number one position. And we continue to try to enhance the game and everything else that, whether I've talked about or during Q&A, we'll talk about it. But we do make sure we keep moving forward and looking at our brand in a future point of view. So speaking of our brand, just wanted to share with you a little bit more of what makes us unique. And we look at it as what we call the brand, if you do any branding work, it's kind of your building blocks of a brand, is our brand essence is intense, meaningful, and unifying. So it comes down to three words of what makes the NFL special and differentiated. So again, it's the intensity, it's that passion, it's the, if you played football, you know the mano a mano, it's every you know, every play matters. It's everything that's very exciting. It doesn't matter whether it's the first quarter or the fourth quarter. It's not like an NBA game where you're only tuning in for the last 2 minutes. Football game, you're there at the beginning, you're watching throughout, it's very exciting. It could be very, you know, think about the, you know, fourth and goal, right? At the 1 yard line. I mean, that's exciting, right? So a lot of intensity in that. And certainly it's meaningful. Our short season is a big difference from a lot of the other, you know, going back to the NBA lockout. One of the reasons the NBA did so well in the lockout last year, not the season before, is because their season was cut in half, and people liked that, actually. It was too many games otherwise. And the ratings actually took off because people knew that those games, each one mattered more. And to some extent, you could argue NHL is doing the same thing this year, and it's not a strategy of theirs by any means. But the point is, we have a short season. You know, in our sport, you go 0-4, that's going to be tough to make the playoffs, right? You go 0-4 in any other sport, hell, you've got over 100 games, right? Or you got a long way to go. So people know our sport, every game matters, and it's important. It's that epic weekly drama, and again, that every moment, that whether it's first down or fourth down, third down, whatever it is, every play is important. And then unifying. Again, we like to think of, you know, the Super Bowl is the biggest culmination of that, but think about how you even probably amongst yourselves, you probably know who's a fan of different sports. And I bet if you, you know, if you knew of a fan who, you know, the same team affinity, you have like an instant bond with that person, right? And then sports does that in general. You just have that normal kind of bond with someone. You know, you go out to eat, you go out and you just find someone who's a fan of the same sport you are, and it's automatically, you know, you can start talking about that sport. But think about that on a broader level. Think about when your team is doing well and it becomes more of a community. And then think about the Super Bowl. That brings an entire nation together and rallying around and seeing who's going to watch, seeing those commercials. There's really nothing like it, certainly in the major sports. I mean, we could argue soccer is like that worldwide, but certainly in the U.S., there's nothing more unifying and bringing people together than the NFL. I mean, the amount of times that we're told to move Super Bowl a couple weeks later to be on President's Day weekend, so they can have a national holiday and not have to go to work the next day, we hear it every year. So, I mean, nobody else is saying that about, you know, Game 7 of the World Series, for example. So, and really just kind of the more emotional and rational things that really go behind the NFL and what makes it so popular. Some of the stuff we already talked about, again, it's that one game per week kind of concept. It's terrific on TV. I mean, whether you have an HD TV or not, the game plays very well on TV. You know, hockey, on the other hand, is shortchanged by being on TV. Hockey is 100 times better in stadium because you can just kind of see the whole ice, you can see the play developing. Football translates extremely well on TV, and it's a big part about it. And it's definitely action-packed. There's very few, you know, down moments. I mean, there's always something going on. I mean, there's tactics involved. You're not, you know, maybe you're not always watching the quarterback. You might be seeing what the wide receiver's doing, the running back. There's a lot of different areas you're looking at. You know, you're seeing what the line is doing, who's sacking who, and there's just a lot of different things that you're going on through the sport. And then for many people, it's kind of that physicality behind it. You know, it's kind of that, again, that hitting each other that, you know, you enjoy when you're a kid or you just enjoy watching it. And so some people really gravitate to the physicality of it as well. And then fantasy football. Fantasy football is big. I mean, it's a small percentage of our audience, but for those people, it's a tremendous audience for us. And it continues to grow. And we love people who play fantasy. Fantasy players are more likely to be avid fans. They're more likely to engage with us more so than any other group out there. And, you know, it's interesting. You're going to watch games that you never would have watched before. You're going to pay attention to players and teams you wouldn't have normally cared about. Fantasy football is definitely a great thing for us. But then there's the entire emotional. So if we consider those kind of rational things, they are what they are. There's really the emotional trigger to it. And the best one we say all the time is hope. So how many go into a season, the NFL, Everybody who's a fan of every team right now probably has hope that their team can make the playoffs. And maybe even win this. You're shaking your head no.
Eagles have no shot.
Eagles, how many worst to first teams have we had? Every year we have a team go from worst to first. Every year. At least one. Okay, so maybe everyone but you has hope. But the majority have hope.
You've been around too long.
Hope is an incredible feeling because you feel like, hey, my team's got it this year. Let me tell you, there's plenty of other sports. I hope I'm not going to insult any Kansas City Royal fans. I don't know why I always pick on them. I have no idea why I do it. So it always comes, the first thing that comes. If you're a Royals fan, I mean, really, do you think you got a shot this year? I don't mean to pick on them, but I mean, you know, baseball, you go into it thinking, I get 500 maybe at best, right? You know, there's other sports. We have parity, and it's a great thing, and it's our business model that generates parity. So you really feel like you have a shot. And, you know, maybe your team surprises you this year. Every year, there's always a team that surprises, and you obviously have the reverse, where there's teams that you sometimes think are going to do tremendously well and, you know, unfortunately don't. But hope is a big thing that, you know, people love about the NFL. Family bonding, we talked about the unifying thing. Culturally unifying. One other thing to touch on the culturally unifying piece is, beyond this, unifying around Super Bowl, is, 9/11. When 9/11 happened, in many ways, the country looked towards the NFL to kind of bring sports back and to make things normal, as normal could be at that time. And it was every other sport that followed suit in how the NFL treated that following weekend. So when we made the decision not to play versus to play, every other sport followed suit. And I'm not exaggerating whatsoever. That's how it happened. People, when we focused, obviously we're in New York, and people would look towards the NFL of how to handle those types of situations and getting back to, again, some type of normalcy. And NFL was able to do that. And so people look at the NFL as a little bit of a beacon in understanding that. I guess the last point here is, certainly United States is bringing in people from a lot of different countries. And what we see is, or through our research is, one of the things, especially with Hispanics, is it's one of their ways of connecting. So, and actually we see it internationally too in some cases, which is for some people, they want to fit in, they want to be like an American. And one of the things that they'll do is they'll learn about the NFL because they feel like that is such an American sport and I want to be an American, I'm in this country, that's how I'm going to feel it and, I'm going to wear the clothing. So that's their connection point for a lot of people that come to this country is through the NFL as well. So the NFL is year-round. This is something that we work on quite a bit. We are not just, you know, the 17 weeks and, you know, the 4 or 5 weeks of the postseason. We have done what I'd like to think is a very good job of making the NFL relevant to you all year round. And why we do that is because as many as you that raised your hand on being an avid fan, what we see is you're an avid fan all year round. You're not just an avid, generally, you're not just an avid fan when the games are on. You're an avid fan now, April 12th, an avid fan when the draft comes around, what your team is going to do this year, what moves they're going to make, what rookies are going to make the team, whatever it is. You follow them all year round, generally. So it's been imperative upon us to give you as much content and as much material to serve your fandom all year round. Now, we started years ago when we created NFL Network to give you that 24/7, 365-day experience. But beyond that, we've created what we call our, you know, tent pole events and tried to do more of them throughout the season to make things more relevant. And so, how many of you watch NFL Combine? Yeah, some. I mean, not a lot. But think about NFL Combine. I mean, NFL Combine is, we've expanded that quite a bit. We put more and more hours on each year. And really, you're just kind of watching guys, you know, run the 40. How many of you watch the NFL Draft? A lot more of you. If you think about the NFL Draft, it is someone standing at a podium calling out names and then the nice big bear hug that the commissioner gives. It is not, you're not, you know, there's no strategy. I mean, there's no, you're not watching a play being called. You're not watching anybody score. It is literally name after name after name being called and, you know, the lovely fans in at Radio City, you know, getting booing or cheering. They're always a fun crowd. But think about how huge that event has become. And it was, it became so big that we moved it into primetime a couple years ago. I mean, it used to be just an entire weekend, Saturday, Sunday, all day. Now we do it. We do an entire round by itself on Thursday night. We do rounds 2 and 3 on Friday, and then the rest of them on Saturday. It's become a bigger and bigger event for us because we know you as fans kind of, you're really interested in all that stuff. So we spend a lot more time on doing that. Some of the newer things that we've done is relating to fantasy, for one, is we actually created a whole fantasy draft week, which is in August, you know, before the season starts. And the idea is to kind of unify, you know, if you're a fantasy player, you know, you set your draft time period. Well, this is an idea that you kind of do it all around the same time period, and we do lots of different events around there. I mean, the new Madden game, it's a Madden launch every year. I mean, it's become a big event in putting out a new video game, so we try to do that. And then even, you know, through the season, hopefully you're familiar with in October, we do all of our breast cancer awareness, so you're seeing a lot of pink around. We do, hopefully you'll, one of the other things you'll start to see is a salute to service that we do also. The Thanksgiving weekend is huge for us. And then, you know, it's all of our playoffs as well. And then, so we really spend a lot of time trying to, you know, figure out how can we make bigger events. We now kind of label the time period, so we're obviously in that path to prime time. Once we move a little bit forward, we start branding everything, you know, back to school, back to football. So we do a lot of branding just to make sure that it continues to be as relevant to you all year round as it is to us. Because I can tell you in our world, there literally is no off season. I think my favorite little quick anecdotal story is, so when I moved to ESPN, I took the job at the NFL. I cannot tell you how many people say, oh, you only have to work 6 months a year now. Yeah, not quite. It is literally, I think the only break we probably get, and break is a marginal word, is the Tuesday after Super Bowl. So we're all flying back Monday, and then Tuesday is probably you're in the office, you're probably just recapping your whole weekend with, you know, people you didn't see. I will tell you that Wednesday you're focused now on, by then you obviously know where the next kickoff game is going to be. You're now focused on the next season. So I think we have about 1 day break. We are working constantly. We're obviously very focused on the draft right now. We're tremendously focused on the Super Bowl that's going to be in MetLife Stadium. So we operate internally 365 or even 364 days a year. So we have no off season. And in my world specifically, right now, the majority of the work that we're focused on is actually recapping this past year There's a tremendous amount of work, and then as soon as we're done doing that, we start into planning for next year. So it's a constant cycle that keeps going. So one of the last slides I'll leave you with, and then we can open up to Q&A, is just a lot of, I just want to briefly talk about some of our initiatives that we're focused on in the league. And you know, first and foremost is really about making it a better, safer game for everybody. It's about being smarter with the types of equipment we're using and making it safer, making sure it's the best product on the field, putting out rule changes that hopefully, you know, benefit everybody going forward. Because, you know, we want to make sure our players are safe now, going forward. The players are what makes who we are. I mean, we have great players and great athletes as part of our game, and we want to make sure that, you know, their careers beyond NFL are as best as possible. So we spend a lot of time on those efforts. And then we want to make sure we're, you know, reaching all of our fans and being very strategic about it. So I touched a little bit upon both from a kid standpoint. Again, this property, this Rush Zone property on Nicktoons I mentioned. We spend a lot of time, you know, it's coming out with not only the TV series, but a whole consumer products line. There's actually a comic book line. There's a lot of things going beyond that, you know, to reach kids of that age. Our Hispanic efforts from an international standpoint as well, we spend a lot of time on. And making sure we expand internationally. And then the stadium experience, all about game day. I think I was talking to some of you earlier, is that it's, you know, the TV experience is great. It has become exponentially better, cheaper, more convenient. We need to make sure that our game day experience is just as strong. We want everybody, you know, filling the seats. All of our revenue streams, our business model is built off of having full stadiums. So we spend a lot of time trying to understand how can we make the best experience possible. Wi-Fi is a huge initiative with us, as you can imagine. I mean, you're all probably used to being able to, you know, check your phones whenever you want, but suddenly when you get into a stadium or arena from every sport, you can't get a signal, you can't communicate with home, it's very frustrating. So we spend a lot of time trying to figure out, you know, how to do that and how to do it right, because it's a huge investment from a monetary standpoint. And if you think about it, what you build today, it, for the amount of money you're going to spend, it better be relevant a couple years down the road. And 10 years, I mean, you're not going to be building a new wireless infrastructure every couple of years. So, and you know, technology, the advances in technology, it's just so, it's tough to keep up with it. So it's something we spend time on. We come out with new products, new events. I mentioned the apparel launch, the women's apparel line that we came out with. No longer is it what we used to be called in the media, the shrink in pink, you know, where you take a guy's jersey, you just make it smaller and you just color it pink, and supposedly every woman in the world's gonna wanna buy it. We realized that, hey, women actually do like other colors than pink, and they don't really want necessarily, you know, there's nothing wrong with having a little, you know, logo here or a little bling here or whatever it is. Women like to wear, you know, women just wanna look good, right? And it doesn't really matter. It doesn't have to be a jersey you wanna look good, and you could just maybe want an accessory, and, you know, women have an affinity to our NFL teams as well. And it really was an untapped segment for us, so we spent a lot of time creating a lot of product. I didn't actually mention NFL Honors. It was actually on the wheel. So NFL Honors was a program. It's kind of our version of our awards program, a show, I should say, where it's both a combination of awards that you're probably already familiar with, like the AP Awards, the Rookie of the Year, the MVP, and then it's a little bit more of our own created type of awards. So that program airs, you know, right the Saturday right before Super Bowl. So that's a program, again, we've created. We just finished our second year of it. Our media platforms, so these are our own platforms that we at the NFL as a property own and run, so NFLnetwork.com, mobile. So again, it's making sure there is the best possible engaging that audience as you know. So we make money two different ways. I mean, we make it through our own products, and then we make it through, you know, all of our partners as well. So we try to just make sure people are as engaged. And then really, the you know, I've mentioned it a couple times, but there's nothing that we do at the NFL that doesn't come back to who we are as a brand. We're extremely protective of our brand. I mean, we literally have people who are, you know, quote unquote brand police internally. There's nothing that we don't do. Everything we do and how we operate, we are a very thoughtful corporation. I'll be the first to admit, we don't we're very, very rarely going to be the first in something. We weren't the first in social media. We're not necessarily going to be the first in every single thing, because we take a very thoughtful process behind how we operate. And our goal isn't necessarily to be the first, and I don't mean like popular first in terms of, so again, social media, I mean, NBA is way far ahead of us in social media, but we wanted to make sure when we put our, dipped our toe in that we did it in a way that was good for our brand and made sure we, crossed the T's, dotted the I's, and everything else that we do. So we go through a very extensive process almost about in everything that we do, and it's in a good way, because we make sure everybody in our company, and it starts with the commissioner, knows it's about the brand. There's no commercial that goes on TV. There's nothing that our sponsors do that isn't reviewed by our internal team. I mentioned the example with, other programs. Everything we do goes through our brand filter and make sure it's the right thing for our brand now and for the long term. So again, everything we do is about the brand, and that's the most important thing to us. So if you came away with nothing else out of this entire presentation, know that the NFL is a strong brand, and it's because we spend so much time protecting our brand and making sure we're as strong as possible. So that's it. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. So I'm completely open to Q&A. So. Yes, sir. Thank you.
In recent years, the NFL has expanded and started to host games in London.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering to what degree analytics play a role in that, and what degree it will play a future in further expansion.
Yep, no, that's a great question. So when we initially, I guess it was 2007 was the first year. So in 2007, when Giants Miami went over, is the role that we played was making sure that it worked. And what I mean by that is we did surveys, research with lots of different entities. We did certainly with the fan base over there. We did with the overall kind of London, UK fan base to understand what they thought of it. Did it make it more of a fan? Just understanding those touch points. We also did with game attendees, the people who bought the tickets to the games, and understanding everything about their experience going to the game. Literally, when did they buy the tickets? Why they bought the tickets? Once you were at the game, what'd you think of the game? What'd you think about all the ancillary things going around the game? But then we spent a lot of time talking with the teams and making sure it logistically it worked for them. So, how was it flying over on a Wednesday or whatever? And we talked to the players and everything that they thought. And we made some operational changes in terms of, flying over earlier. So we made sure we looked at the whole thing holistically. Make sure we looked at everything in totality, to make sure that it worked on all elements and all cylinders. And we made some changes. So the answer was yes, it seemed to have worked. We need to make some operational changes, but it was a great experiment. So we came back the following year. Subsequent research from there is less about asking the team. I mean, other than the anecdotal stuff, we obviously converse with the teams. But from a research standpoint, we're not really talking to the players anymore. We've learned that it works. We spend a lot more time in my world measuring the fan base and talking to the attendees and making sure that our fan base, and we see that our fan base slowly but surely continues to grow in the UK. And that led us to the decision this past year, which I referenced at the top, is so this year we're playing two games over there, which was a very, very big move for us to go from one to two. And then part of the discussion is, okay, so you play two games. Is it back-to-back weeks? Is it a month apart? How do you do it? And then you got to work with your broadcast networks because they got to shuttle their, equipment over and everything like that. And then the next big role that we'll have is kind of the little secret sauce that we figured out through internationally is, internationally, you're not really, obviously not growing up, you're not growing up necessarily with the sport. And what we learned through our research is how people became a fan of their different teams and what that does for you as a fan. So. And perhaps maybe they flew over to America and caught, beyond the expats who live over there is, again, perhaps they caught a game here when they're in America, perhaps their family is in a particular, maybe they live in Chicago and they're a Bears fan. It may have been when we used to do preseason games, the American Bowl, and they got exposed that way. But what we find out there is that once you have it's no different than here, really, is once you have a favorite team, then again, you're off the charts in how much you're caring about the sport. So knowing that insight that we discovered, which is a bit of an intuitive one, but it's nice to kind of measure it, is it now led us to the Jacksonville Jaguars going over there every year for the next couple of years. And with the goal, I mean, it's good for them and it's good for us at the league, with the goal that hopefully people, they become a favorite team for people there. Because maybe you didn't have a team. And, you know, it's just your way to engage with any team. And if you see them over, you know, regularly and you get familiar with the players and, you know, the idea is that they become your favorite team. So we continue to play a role in that respect. We do research way beyond just the UK. I mean, we do it at Mexico, Canada, all of Asia. So we constantly are measuring our fan bases worldwide. But yeah, in that case with the Wembley game, there was actually a ton of research over the past 5 years involved. Yes, ma'am. In my I was going to ask you is what specific group. So I'd say the in my group, the number one thing, well, you have to have an analytical mind, I would say, first of all. So I'm definitely a numbers person. And then, you know, some of the other things that go along with is being detailed oriented. We are inundated with numbers in our world. And if you think about even all the Nielsen ratings, I mean, there's an inordinate number of numbers. The information our group puts out there, especially with the Nielsen ratings, goes public. You can't be wrong, let me tell you. It's not a good thing. So it goes to so many different people. So you really have to have an attention to detail like you wouldn't believe. I guess the other piece of it is really kind of that innate ability to connect the dots. So I do lots of different research studies and lots of different things. And it's great when you could take an insight from one completely different study and be like, oh yeah, that makes sense, and that ties in with that research I did over here. And in my world, it's about knowing, what I like to say is my job is to represent the fan. I know everything about the fan and how they feel and act and what they do behaviorally. And it's having that whole 360, you know, point of view of everything the fan does. So it's a little bit of understanding what they're doing digitally and TV to present a holistic picture. I would say beyond that, especially in my world, because I deal with people, I deal with the commissioner, I deal with people, a lot of senior people, is not everybody's a numbers person, and nobody wants to sit through, let me tell you, the commissioner doesn't even want to sit through a presentation like this. I mean, it's just because he's a busy guy. So my thing is, you know, you hear it all the time, that elevator speech, I need to be able to condense what he needs to know in one simple bullet. So it's the ability to take the information and condense it and be relevant to somebody in a completely different business who doesn't want to, nobody wants to see all these zillion numbers. They want to know if we're doing well or not and what's the key takeaway. So it's being able to tell a story to a bunch of non-researchers in a way that's relevant and hopefully actionable to them. And a lot of that comes with experience. A lot of that's just about, you know, having that storytelling ability as well. Great question. Yes, sir. The most business value? I'd like to think we contribute business value to everybody. A greater impact. Well, I think PR loves us just because we give them all their information and all their write-ups to go out with. Yeah, I would say probably on the whole, I don't know if it's in our world, it probably doesn't really serve a specific group, but all the work that we do on the game day, and arguably maybe it's the teams that we serve the most, because the teams aren't doing this type of research. They either don't have the money or the people to do it. So for the amount of work that we actually do on behalf of the teams, it's probably much more appreciated just because they literally have nothing else. So the stuff that we do, and again, some of you heard me talk about it earlier or during lunch, is the work we do for teams on their game day experience and every single touch point of how their fans are viewing there is tremendous because that's completely actionable on their standpoint to take. If they're finding that, you know, there's issues with a cup holder, let me tell you, they can fix that cup holder the next day. If they're finding issues that the wait times or the security lines are too long in certain areas, they can make those fixes. So It's a tough one for me to answer because we'd like to, you know, provide value to all different groups. But those, I would say the teams are probably by far and away, again, because they don't have anything else to do anything with. There was a question, yes, in the back. So I'll take your first question first, which is what we call our corporate social responsibility, CSR initiatives. And that's everything that we do with breast cancer, the Salute to Service, some of the things I touched on earlier. And they're definitely a tougher connection of how do you know that you're making an impact. But in our world, we measure awareness of all those initiatives. We'll look at how that makes you feel towards the NFL. You know, in the breast cancer way, we put out a lot of products, and actually, we don't get any of the, by the way, if you buy any of the breast cancer awareness products, we don't get any of the proceeds to any of that. So it's understanding the connection there. It's understanding how, I guess I got to reference it, you know, how it makes you feel towards the NFL. So we'll measure that, but it's definitely a tougher thing to know if you're moving the needle on some of these initiatives. We'll look at see if people are really understanding the messages we're trying to get across with each of those initiatives. But it's always just a tougher direct relationship. We just know, in a lot of cases, you know that you need to be in those areas. In the case of breast cancer awareness, that one actually stemmed from the commissioner's wife, who was very heavily involved in that. And then what we found is that when you go out and talk to the players, good majority of them knew someone in their life, whether it was their mom or their aunt or whoever, that had a connection to it. And it just made sense for us to really look at the program. And so for us to be involved in that, it was just a good thing for us. The traumatic brain injury is different. I mean, it's one that we're obviously focused on from a league in terms of, you know, financial support. From a straight research support, again, I will be surveying, you know, fans like yourselves to see if you're aware of the initiatives that we're doing, to understand your opinion towards those initiatives in terms of whether we're doing enough, is it the right things. We have a lot of individual programs in there. There's a program called the Heads Up program that with USA Football in terms of, providing equipment to areas that don't necessarily have the financial means to have that equipment. So we'll look at specific programs and just, again, whether you're fans are familiar with that, and but a lot of it ties into PR and it's putting out the right messaging out there to make sure people are aware. So we do a lot of measurement. It's just always tougher in those areas to know if there's that one-to-one impact. In our world, sometimes just people making sure people are aware of what we're doing is just as important. Hopefully that answered your question. Yes, sir. Connect with the youth?
Yeah.
You know, I don't think it matters in terms of whether it's a small market, big market. I mean, we encourage teams to do kids clubs. So, it doesn't really matter. In general, your kids clubs are with your local fans. They're less about being national. So there's no reason why, they can't get the kids fans in that area and engage on a local. I mean, there's so much locally that you can do, whether it's in the elementary schools, the middle schools, whatever it is, have groups of kids come to the stadium as well. And yeah, I mean, it's definitely a struggle anytime a team is not doing nearly as well. But, you know, kids, first of all, especially young kids, aren't necessarily caring as much about the win-loss. They just kind of want to be engaged and having fun and be part of a program that makes them feel part of something bigger, really. So we encourage all of our teams to do it. We don't really see an issue of whether you're a big market or a small market, especially on a youth level. I mean, if the goal is to get more national fans, I mean, that's a kind of a different thing. But locally on the youth side, there's plenty anybody can do.
Yes, sir. Can you talk about maybe the work like your area of the NFL does as far as research in the past for like relocating teams and any work you guys are doing in the future for the team that's like Los Angeles or something?
Yeah, the work that we do, so actually the work there that we do is actually completely, not completely different, is very different, is we would look at if there's a hypothetical scenario of X team potentially moving to X location, we, it's less about fan interest level. We'll spend a lot of time mostly on a ratings side, TV ratings side, to understand the impact of the loss of that team in the market versus the gain of the team. So it's actually understanding more the makeup of the market to know financially, in our world, at least from a rating standpoint, whether it makes sense. So we'll put together, we do a lot of modeling in that case to see where the pluses and minuses are, because you obviously, you might gain, but you got to see how much you're going to potentially lose. And we, you know, might look at, you know, what makes sense for the best team, best location, that type of thing. Why is everyone laughing?
Sacrificial lamb.
Why is everyone laughing? That's a fair question. There's a couple things that went into that. One, the team had to have wanted to do that. There were teams that, you know, raised their hand to volunteer to do that. And, you know, truthfully, I mean, for them, it made sense in a couple different ways. I mean, you know, to some extent, they struggled on the ticket sales standpoint. But really, the majority of the reason that it made sense for them primarily is they have a new owner, Shad Khan, who's really, he's our first really international owner. And he's a very good businessman, and he understood the value of creating a brand. And Jacksonville, you know, you talk about small market. I mean, Jacksonville is a very small market, and you can expand your reach a little bit, but then, you know, you bump into the Dolphins on one, you know, you bump into the Dolphins, you got Tampa, and you bump into Atlanta. So there's only so much you can expand when you're surrounded by, you know, other teams. You know, there's only so much, you know, stealing fans that you're going to be able to do. So he realized the opportunity for him was to grow globally. And so, I mean, I think, I'm assuming you're laughing because they haven't had the best win-loss record, and it's like, why put that team over there? But again, the connection for people overseas isn't necessarily win-loss. I mean, to some extent it is. But again, it's that whole familiarity with the team. And, you know, already, I mean, once it was announced, I mean, they're over there a lot. The merchandise, the game is already sold out. And, you know, their merchandise is selling. And for him and for the team, if that's where they gain their brand and gain who they are and people become recognized, it's a win-win. So it made sense in just everything that we evaluated, their own circumstance in domestically in their area that they're in, and then the best opportunity to be international and grow from there. So it was it's obviously a joint decision of what team wanted to participate and what team we thought from a league perspective made sense. So it's great. I mean, we look at it. I mean, there's so much having that one team there every year. It makes it there's a lot of things actually makes easier, and it's incredible for us to see how they're going to continue to grow. You know, whether it's, you know, website visits from international locations has grown for them already. You know, those little things, they add up and are really important to teams. So it's good.
Yes. Can you speak on your role from an analytical side about moving the Pro Bowl, like
Oh, excellent. Yeah, that was research was heavily involved in that. So it's always interesting. So you saw how great a brand Super Bowl is. We really sat there and thought about it and said, okay, you have this incredible, you know, culmination of the season with the Super Bowl and hopefully a great game. And then what, a week later, the Pro Bowl? Yeah. So one of the things with the Pro Bowl is interesting. If you go back to that brand essence slide that I had, intense, meaningful, and unifying, one of the things I should say about that slide is that's a filter that we use for everything that we do as well. So I talked about a brand filter, but that's really it. We make sure everything we do kind of matches those things. And so take the Pro Bowl. Is the Pro Bowl intense? No, right? I mean, is the Pro Bowl meaningful? No, right? Is it unifying? You know, somewhat, maybe, you know? Actually, still does, believe it or not, actually does very well relative to other sports, actually does very well in the ratings. So we looked at the Pro Bowl and said, it's not measuring up to who we are as a brand. So, and really, is that what we want our culmination or our season be? It's the Pro Bowl, right? I mean, the Super Bowl is the, you know, the big kahuna, if you will, right? We want to make sure people end on that. So that was the decision to move it into the week before. If you recall, we also did a little bit of an experiment, if you will. We brought it to the mainland. I don't know if you remember a couple years ago. Yeah, I remember. We brought it to Miami. We brought it to where the Super Bowl was the one year. That was an attempt to actually be more unifying, and for a lot of people who perhaps couldn't go to the Super Bowl, you could go to the Pro Bowl and rally around it in a community for 2 weeks instead of just 1 week time period. We were contractually obligated to be back in Hawaii, so there was a lot of that going on. But we still struggle with this Pro Bowl. I'm telling you probably nothing you don't know. I mean, it's tough to be intense. I mean, it's an all-star game. No, there's no all-star game of any sport that's intense, right? I mean, it's a bunch of, you know, alley-ooping in basketball. Meaningful is something we're working on. We're not gonna be like MLB and decide, you know, who plays at home based on the results of it. We're working together a lot with the players. They, again, I don't know how much you read in the news, I'm always a little too close to it to know, but the players really stepped it up this year in terms of making it a more meaningful game and making it a little bit more intense. And, you know, there was a lot of players who previously wouldn't have come when they got honored. This year, that a lot more of them came. They took the game a little bit more seriously. They it wasn't just a vacation in Hawaii with their family, right? They spent a lot more time. And we're hoping that continues. A lot of it, if you ask me where the Pro, if what's going to happen to the Pro Bowl in 3 years, I have no idea. I mean, we don't know. So, but that's something we're trying to figure out how it can live up to our. Is there something else we can do with it to make sure it hits on check boxes on all three of those things? Because we struggle right now with it as a property. Yeah, I mean, you know, from a fan standpoint, I think people look at that. You still have a zillion other stars to follow, and I don't think it's probably as big a deal as people say it is. But yeah, I mean, it's definitely one of the things we look at because you want to be all-inclusive. But I think those guys would rather play in the Super Bowl. I would think. Yes, Barry. Yeah, I mean, I'll go beyond the apparel because I think I talked about that. Interestingly enough, though, we've always had a really good appeal to women. I think one of the things that has actually been done, mostly on the team level, is a lot of teams have created two things, which is sometimes these football 101 programs. There's definitely a lot of women who totally understand the sport, get it, love it, you know, can follow it. But for a lot of other women, it's they become fans through someone else in their family or as a way to connect. Perhaps their son is playing and it's a way for them to converse and be connected to it. But in doing so, you want to actually kind of a little bit more understand the sport. And, you know, we always hear the stories. Nobody wants to, you know, bother the person watching TV and saying, oh, what happened there and why? You know, some people don't want to be bothered answering questions. So a lot of the teams, like Ravens were the first in doing it. They've been incredible in doing it. They created, you know, these football 101 programs where, you know, a bunch of women would come in, they'd explain the sport, they'd have them meet some players and everything along the way. But those types of programs we do. And then some of the other teams will do women's clubs, so kids clubs, but for women. And it's just a way to introduce them or to get them more engaged. So we definitely push those efforts as well. But in general, we have a very strong, about 40, almost 45% of our fans are, if you look at our makeup, it's about our women, which has always been fairly strong. Actually hasn't changed. I mean, we grow in the number, but the percentage has always been pretty strong. How about you? Yeah, I think I touched on a little bit there. We'll look at the financial impact of what that does, both, you know, in LA, but then also where the team potentially could be coming from and what it would do in that particular market. So a lot of it's a lot of financial modeling. Perhaps it's on the rating side. You know, it's understanding. I mean, there's the whole financial impact of the stadium and how you're going to draw from. So. A lot of different things that do, and that goes way beyond our world. There's definitely a lot more that goes on, but that's something we've done a little bit on.
One last question.
I promised you.
Does the recent narrow research have any concussions
Can you just repeat the question? Sorry, I just want to make sure I understand.
Recent neuro research on concussions and role changes have any effect on the strength of the brand and the demographics of the fans?
Demographics, no. I mean, they are what they are. From a strategy of the brand, yeah, I mean, we look at, I mean, we obviously make sure it's a priority that we focus on and make sure that the efforts, again, that we're doing through there are, you know, who we are, true to our brand and what we want to be doing. And something, you know, we spend an awful lot of time talking about it. So again, it's making sure we're strong. And I mean, the rule changes are definitely relevant to that. I mean, it goes back to what I said earlier. I mean, we want to make the game as safe as possible. Not every player is going to love the rules, but it's for their benefit, and they may not realize it now, but everything we do is really for them and for, you know, making them as strong and us as strong as possible.
Thank you, Alicia, for engaging.
Thank you.